ओके, गुड मॉर्निंग। ओके, सो लास्ट लेक्चर में हमने सो वी वर टॉकिंग अबाउट कंपाइल टाइम पॉलीमॉर्फिज्म। कंपाइल टाइम पॉलीमॉर्फिज्म में वी हैव सीन मेथड ओवरलोडिंग, वी हैव ऑलरेडी सीन विद द एग्जांपल इन जावा। ऑपरेटर ओवरलोडिंग व्हिच इज नॉट सपोर्टेड इन जावा, बट इट इज वन ऑफ द इम्पोर्टेंट कॉन्सेप्ट्स इन कंपाइल टाइम पॉलीमॉर्फिज्म। एंड that we were discussing what is operator overloading. So basically all the operators that have some that works on primitive data types like plus, minus, multiplication and all, you can overload this operator also. So basic operator overloading is provided by different languages like plus with integers can will add the numbers, and plus with strings will concatenate those two strings. So some language already provide some basic operator overloading, but since we are talking about object oriented programming and we want to work with directly on the objects, and so for example if you have an object one and you directly want plus to work with the objects and assign it to some other objects rather than calling add function through object 3 that we usually do, and we pass the objects in the function of add. So we want to work with operators directly on the objects. That's why operator overloading comes into the picture. And before moving to basic difference, basic things we have already discussed, and like what are the operators that you can overload in C++. So basically jo maine abhi upar bataya hai ki if you create a class objects, you want to directly work with the objects. And some of the things that that need to mention, you cannot change the arity of the operator. That is, you can overload operator to work with objects, but let's say plus work, so plus is a binary operator, it takes two operands, so you cannot change that. You can change the arity of the operator. These are the set that we have discussed, that which operators can be overloaded and which cannot be. Some of the basic restrictions, that precedence of operator cannot be changed. Associativity of the operator, you cannot change. Arity, that is number of operators that it takes, you cannot change. That is, unary operator remains unary, binary operators remains binary, operator ampersand or star, that is multiplication, plus, minus, each have unary and binary versions. So dono versions, unary binary versions can be overloaded separately. One more thing, no new operator can be created, only using existing operators. No overloading operators for built-in data types. So basically, operator overloading is to work with the objects that you create. Member versus non-member function, before coming onto that, make one second, make टैब शेयर कर रहा हूँ। ओके सो बेसिकली व्हाट वी हैव सीन इन जावा दैट व्हाटएवर यू राइट इनसाइड द क्लास सो यू डिक्लेयर सम क्लास एंड इवन अ मेन फंक्शन यू राइट इनसाइड दिस क्लास बट इन सी प्लस प्लस सिंस इट फॉल it is object oriented programming as well as procedure oriented programming so there might be chance that you have some functions that are outside the main function or outside the class definition so basically in c++ suppose if you define a class a and with some properties and the behavior for the objects you can instead you can have some functions outside the class so those are called global functions or in object oriented programming we call it non member functions so you can write some functions outside the class and from the definition of encapsulation that is the behavior or the methods that you write inside the class definition also call it member function if you read in c++ this behavior is only applicable on the object of this classes object of this classes that is that it works with the data members of this classes only so it can access so this function can access the data members or the instance variable or the property whatever you want to call it can access the data member of the same class However, the non-member function that is outside the class cannot access it, and that's why we call it encapsulation. That data and the behavior are together wrapped up in a single entity called class. So that outside the functions outside the classes cannot access it. So this is the difference between non-member and member functions. And there is another term called friend functions. I'm just giving you the basic introduction so friend functions are the functions that are not the member of this class but can access the data so we create some function that are friend to some classes so non member functions cannot access the private data of other class friend function can access the data so these are the three terms that you will see in the slides and in the examples that we are going to see now so basically member versus non-member function now the thing is operator overloading you can define the operator function as a member function, as a non-member function, and as a friend function. So there are three ways. So if you are defining it as a non-member function, you have to define it as a member function of that class. So member versus non-member, how you're going to write? So the operator function that you're going to write, it can be member or non-member function. That it can belong to the same class or some other class. So outside the class, when overloading this. Three operators or any of the assignment operators, it must be a member function, and we'll see why. We'll see why it should be member function. Because what compilers do, basically, when you write, let's say two objects S1 and S2, you are adding them. So compiler actually translate into something like this, that the first leftmost operand left operand will become the caller object. So s1 dot operator plus that you have defined, and s2 the right operand is actually passed into the operator function. Now the restriction is that if you define your operator overloaded function as a member function, so basically if you are defining as a member function, then compiler translate this into this, because you always call with the object of that class. So that means the operator overloaded member functions that invoked on the first operand, and this is how member function works. Now on some of the operands, when operating the overloading this or the script or reference or any of the assignment operator, it must use a member function. Why? Because suppose you have a pointer to a link, a node of linked list, so you always write a of data and the next the two fields. So you see the left side is always should be always the object. So you cannot write data arrow a. So that's why when overloading this key, it should be defined as a member function. It must be defined as a member function. Operator function can also be defined as a non-member function, but it must be friend if needed to access the private or protected member of the class. But what are the advantages of if you define as a member function and if you define as a non-member function? What if the first operand is not a class? So something like this. So for example, if you define it as a member function, you can always call it like s1 is equal to, let's say, s1 plus, let's say, some integer 1. And integer is not an object, so it does not belong to the class. So you want to increment into object directly. Then if you see, s1 must be a member of a class, member function should be a member function, and if you have defined as a member function, then it will work fine. However, you cannot write 1 plus s1 in case if you have defined as a member function, because left operand is not the object of that class. So basically that's the major problem if you want to overload an operator where the first operand is not class type. For example, this 10.0 is a double value, it's not an object, then it won't work. So you have to always write s2 plus 10 plus 10.0, and that is s1 plus 10.0, it will always work. To solve this ordering problem, we can define the operator overloaded function as a friend function, that is the function that is outside the class, but it can access the private members. To make it friend only, we only make it friend when we need to access the private member. Otherwise, simply make it as a non-member function. How actually it does? So you write class, the class class name in C++. So I think yahan pe column aate hain, and in between the opening brackets and closing brackets, or that is another thing that you have to keep in mind, that when you are working with C++, there is a semicolon at the end of the definition of the class, which is not in the Java. So you define a member function inside the class by writing the keyword like return type operator keyword, operator reserved keyword, and the symbol that you want to overload, and you pass the argument list. Basically, these things are the same as return type have the same meaning. Return type of the function is followed by the operator keyword and the symbol. Symbol means the plus, less than, minus, plus, plus, what operator that you want to overload. And you can pass the argument to operator function in a similar way as a function. Now, it was on the operator overloading on the binary operators. If you are overloading unary operators, for example, if you want to directly post increment the object, similarly that you work with the primitive types. Operator overloading can be overloaded with no arguments or one argument. So basically, if you are defining inside the class is a member function, so it will be converted into a dot operator plus plus and that's it, because it need not to have an argument, because the object that you are going to call is already mentioned and it's a unary operator. If there is another operand, you need to pass it as an argument. So if you are defining inside the class definition as a member function, then it can be overloaded with the no argument or one argument in case of you are defining outside the class as a non-member function. So basically, जिन्होंने starting में object oriented programming के starting में जब हमने we connected a poll and those who are thinking that C with the C++ it might be easier because they know C++ programming, but अगर जिनके मन में ऐसा था कि C++ ले लेते हैं, पढ़ना नहीं पड़ेगा और last में पढ़ लेंगे, तो C object oriented programming with C++ is quite complex compared to the object oriented programming in Java, because there are lots of things, because you're going to have an non class examples also. So object oriented programming mein jaise Java mein to sab kuch class mein likh rahe hain, but agar bahar likh rahe hain then kya hoga, fir sabke liye alag alag conditions hoti hain, and if you have studied then it is fine. It should always implement it as a member function because you don't want to violate the encapsulation property of the class. So declare as a member function. So let's say, so you can write inside the class definition, operator not equal to, so not actually not equal to, it's not. So not will return a boolean type true or false, and the const keyword is normally when, so we are not going into detail of this. So const keyword is actually used when you want to indicate that this function is not going to change any value. So value will be remain same, and that there is no change in the or the modification on the content. It is just the want to check the so you want to check the whether it's not or not. Declare outside the class also. So for example, so okay, yahan pe ek mistake hai, the class should be end here and friend, okay, or basically yahan pe aapka semicolon hona chahiye tha because you're declaring it. So you can write a declaration inside the function that this function will going to access the private member you are defining as a friend using friend keyword, and the definition of this function is goes outside the class. So why not just go to the example. So example bhi chalte hain. So for example, let's say plus equal to operator, if you want to overload binary operator. So जैसे हमने पहले भी देखा कि y plus is equal to z will be equivalent to the y dot operator plus equal to and z you are passing as an argument. So मैं example पे चलता हूँ. So this is the example. So these two are the basic things when you write a programming in C++. You're defining a class complex. So same thing goes with the class definition here. So you can see class is starting from here and ending here. Now, we have defined two private variables, real and imaginary, because we are writing a class complex. And this is the constructor, similar to Java. In Java, you write public as a access modifier in front of the class. Here you write as a block initializer, that all the things that will follow this public colon is actually the public, and all the things that follow the private is private, until unless you specify another block initializer. So this is the constructor, and in C++ you can merge a default constructor and the parameters constructor together into single definition. So here you see int r is equal to 0 and I is equal to 0 it is written. That is, if you don't pass anything, r and I will be initialized to 0. Otherwise, real will initialize to r and imaginary value will initialize to I. And we have a function, simple function, to print it. Now we want to add two complex numbers by just writing this. Like C1 plus C2 is good, and we are assigning to some object. So there are two ways. Either you can write inside the class definition as a member function, or you write outside. This is the example of writing outside. So if you see, if you're writing outside the class definition as a non-member function, you have to define it as a friend of this class, because you want to access this private data that is real and imaginary. So you write as a friend function. For writing a friend function, write a declaration of friend function inside the class. So it starts with the friend keyword, and the class, so because it is going to return, because you want to work with C1 plus C2, and you want to assign it to C3. That is the object of that class. So basically, the return type is complex. Operator is keyword, and operator symbol, that is plus, and you see it is taking two arguments, because it is not the member of the class. It is the outside of the class as a non-member function. So it will take two arguments, C1 and C2 both. However, if it were defined inside the class as a member function, you could have provided only one argument. If you see here, and one object will be the caller of the object in case of member function. So we have declared as a friend, and outside this class definition, you can define it as a, you can define this function. So it is taking two object references, C1 and C2. And again, you see we are writing const keyword in declaration that it is not, so we are not changing the content of the objects. We are just adding the values, and we are returning a other object. So it is returning complex, and the bracket inside the bracket, it is adding real value, that is c1.real and c2.real, comma c1.image and c2.image, and you're passing it, it is returning as a non-referenced object. So aapne ek object return kiya hai. And when it is returned, it is assigned to C3. So basically C3 refer to that object. And you are just printing it the value of C3 and you're return. So this is how operator overloading works. So since it's an important concept, I just want to know if you are, sir, will it work with? Yes, it will. So yes, you can define a string as a class, and you can define the functions. Yes, it will work if you have defined class a string. So if you have any doubt, you please ask, because this is the important concept, and though we are covering with Java almost, but still, if you want to ask, you can ask. So that two, three points, the basic points that you have to always remember. One, if you're writing inside the class as a member function, then number of arguments will be changed as compared to the as a parent function outside the class. And which operators you can overload, which operators you cannot overload, which operators you should define as a member function only, and so on. So okay, so either you write an equation or you write just move ahead. Okay, so if you are writing pre-increment, then you always define as a member function only. And if you want to work as a post, if you want to have writing the flexibility for only, so for both pre-increment, post-increment, you can write it as a parent function. That's the basic difference between declaring this pre and post increment operator. And okay, no questions. So we'll go ahead. And there are some other difference also, actually, pre and post increment, overloading pre and post increment, but we are not going to do that. Okay, so iska to example hai aage. Stream insertion and stream accession. One second. Okay, so this is it. Basically, we are going to cover that example also. That is, you want to print, or you want to take the input directly into the objects, or you want to just give the output of the object as a output directly. So you can overload the stream extraction or the stream insertion operators. It is overloaded to perform the input output for the user defined data type. Left operand will always be a left operand of type jo bhi iska left operand hoga, that is cout or cin. So cout is basically object of this class or object of this type, and cin is normally object of this. So whenever we write C in and C out, we always write that's C out and stream extraction operator, and you can write directly object if you want to print the object value on C. Now, this is the important part. You're going to overload this operator. You can see C out and C in are not the object of the user defined class that you are going to define. So this, the left operand is always the object of a class that is outside the user defined class. Basically, they are the objects of OStream and IStream class. So left operand is not an object of the class, so it should be defined as a non-member function. Because you have a member function is a defined kiya, so then left operand ke through left operand will become a caller object. So you don't want to do that. So you always defined as a non-member function. And it also should be friend to access the private. This is the example. Unicode IOStream, you can avoid that using writing just using namespace standard std. Set width, if you are going to use, because in this function it is going to use, suppose there is a class phone number and you have defined two operators, operator functions, one with the stream extraction and one with the stream insertion, and the left of the one argument is type of OStream and in iStream, and it is taking object of this class as an argument. So we have two arguments, because if you see cout has, you know, okay, so cout is the object of OStream class, an object that you are going to directly print or give the output as an output is this class. And for stream extraction, you're writing reference of phone number class as a const, because you're not going to change the content of the object, you are just printing it. And in case of stream insertion operator, you're actually modifying the content of the object, so it is not declared as a const. Basic private data type. Now you see the class is ended here, and outside the class definition goes like this, the operator and this is taking output as first argument, and with the output what you are doing with the stream extraction, you are just printing. So small bracket, opening bracket is printed as it is, number dot area code, because this jo object hai uska area code pehla data member, and the bracket, closing bracket is printed as it is, and num dot exchange you are printing, and then hyphen and the num dot line, and you are returning this object as an output. Similarly, you go with the stream extraction operator, and you are taking an input. So you are taking input num dot area code, num dot exchange, and dot line. So inside the main function, now unlike C++, unlike Java, you write main function outside the class definition. It need not to be in a class. It is not actually in the class. So here, unlike Java, whenever you declare a reference, the object is also created. So you write class name and the object reference. It automatically calls the default character provided by the programming language, for here in this example C, and the object is created. Cout enter the phone number in the format, because we have taken we are taking input as a in this format, so we are asking for this. So for input dot ignore, for this we are ignoring it. Area code we are taking it again here, we are skipping this, and you skip dash also, and you are taking the number of lines. So basically in form of this, you want to take input, you can directly write C in, and you can directly input the object, and if you want to print it, you can directly also print it the object. So basically enter the phone number in the form of this, printed as it is, and you have given the number in this form, and it is printing. So that's the actually main use of the object oriented operator overloading in C++. I think that we should not go into the case study. You can read it the idea was to give you basic intro of operator overloading in C++. So any question on operator overloading or जो हमने अभी तक पढ़ा है उस पे? ओके, कोई क्वेश्चन नहीं, ठीक है. ओके, सो बिफोर स्टार्टिंग न्यू टॉपिक, सो वी आर स्टॉपिंग हियर. हम नेक्स्ट टॉपिक को नेक्स्ट क्लास में स्टार्ट करेंगे. एंड बिफोर स्टार्टिंग अ न्यू टॉपिक दैट इज इनहेरिटेंस एंड अदर टॉपिक्स, विल सी इन अ प्रैक्टिकल एग्जांपल. नेक्स्ट क्लास में मैं आपको we'll see in a practical example for writing code. And then in Java, and what are the basic things that you have to remember when you are writing object oriented programming Java? Okay, thank you.